Hi, I'm Dr. Ken Miller, and I'm the director of the Adult Cancer Survivorship Program at the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute. I'm very fortunate today to have with me and with us Irene Goss-Werner, who is a social worker and a member of the GYN oncology team. Irene, thanks for being with us.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
So, a woman, let's say, has been treated for cervical cancer or uterine cancer, or is just finished the initial part of treatment for ovarian cancer. And on one hand, you know, everyone's thinking, oh, this is a great time of celebration. You finished your treatment. But I guess it's not all a joyful occasion for everyone, is it?
I think many times I hear from women, what's going on? What's wrong? I'm really perplexed. I've been counting the seconds until I reach this point of ending treatment, and now I have a lot of ambivalent feelings. I'm very anxious, yet the world around me is very excited and anticipating that I'm just going to be going, you know, forward normally. And I think there are so many things going on for women when they reach this point in their cancer experience. Number one, the psychological safety net of treatment is being removed. And while that's a reason for rejoicing, you know, at the same time, it's a real adjustment. They won't be seeing their team as much. The specter of the fear of recurrence is much more prominent in their mind. And I think in general, some of those issues and concerns that have been there from the time of diagnosis but have been more on the back burner come to the forefront at this time and become more prominent issues, both for a patient and her support system. Having said that, while a support system may be present and wanting to be supportive and go forward, a patient can actually feel quite isolated, more so than even during her treatment, because the disconnect in reality of what she's experiencing may be quite different than the world around her.
I want to ask you more about that, because I think that's a really interesting point. The word disconnect, or I've heard the word dyssynchrony in the past. What is the disconnect?
Well, I think that frequently a woman may find herself just reverberating from the impact of what she's just been through. Mm-hmm. I know often going through treatment there really is not a lot of time except to put one foot in front of the other mm-hmm. to get through the process. And at the time that it ends, you know, I think she can be flooded with a different dimension of what the impact of this has been in her life. Sometimes, unless I think the people in her life, her support system and other people around her, unless they've been through an experience like that or know someone who has, don't always realize that this actually is the beginning of a new adjustment period, which in many respects is as challenging and perhaps more challenging in some levels because of the issues that people deal with then as they're going forward. The fear of recurrence, living with uncertainty, really living the question, how do I not let cancer control my life? Mm-hmm. And in living those questions, sometimes I think a patient can find herself trying to educate other people that in fact what she is experiencing in her inner life is quite different than what they might expect.
Well, so they may be seeing her physically, that her hair has grown back, she, you know, gained some weight,
right,
or she's starting to look like herself again. It sounds like what you're saying is that even that may be a disconnect also, because the inside inner life may be different than how she looks outside.
Right. And many times I think during this phase, people actually can do the most significant part of their grief work mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Because there often is not the luxury, the time, the energy during treatment, but grieving the visible and the invisible losses. And I think validation and affirmation that there are very intangible, invisible losses that are real things to be grieved. And that also is an experience that sometimes I think the world around you mm-hmm. Doesn't appreciate just because they haven't been through that themselves.
It sounds like there, you know, when people finish treatment, a lot's happening. There's some grief, There is some searching for meaning. There's maybe an adjustment. How long does that take?
Well, that can certainly vary from person to person, and I think that's an important part of normalizing the experience at end of treatment for people, that there isn't a crystal ball to know exactly how long this will take. Mm-hmm. But understandably, adjustment is a process in time, and it can be very different for different people. Some people will express to me their impatience or concern that they're still experiencing residual side effects from their treatment, wondering, when is this fatigue going to really be reduced? When am I going to, the crispness of my cognition, my memory, my ability to focus and concentrate, what does it mean that I'm still having difficulty? And I think it is important for people to know that it is a process. It does take time for other people as well. And I think sometimes trying to share the wisdom and the range of experiences from other patients can be very helpful in normalizing. Since there isn't really a roadmap for people during the post-treatment phase, at least to have an idea of what the range of experiences can be, and to know that what they might be experiencing is certainly not unusual.
So it sounds like talking with other people can be helpful.
Absolutely. In fact, I think that the role of support groups can be as important, if not more so, at the end of treatment, where there's an opportunity to network with other peers and other patients who are further out serving as mentors for people as they go through this period that's open-ended and somewhat, usually a mystery for people entering into it.
Let me ask you about relationships. What kind of adjustments occur after treatment's over?
Well, I think that for a couple going through an experience like this, one thing often, even prior to the end of treatment phase that happens, is realization of if they have similar or different coping styles. Mm-hmm. And I think that process continues during the adjustment period. I know that for some people, a partner may be excited, wanting to go forward, and not understanding why the patient is really not feeling in a congruent way with what she or he may be feeling as a partner. A partner usually has taken on a range of roles that are perhaps not usual for them. So once again, it's a shifting of roles that takes place. The whole issue of sexuality and intimacy is significant, I think, for anyone going through a cancer experience. For women on our service, I think it also, there's some added dimensions, given the fact that women often go through surgery, may be going through menopause and associated symptoms, not congruent with what their biological time clock may have been, had this not happened in their life.
How about people that are single, that are not in a committed relationship?
We have a lot of single patients on our service, and very challenging for them, I think, in going through the early survivorship phase of, being concerned and worried about what that might look like, feeling very vulnerable of being hurt and wondering what this might mean in sharing this information. Will they be rejected because of what they've been through? So some of the things that we will often talk about is actually rehearse or identify what, when, how to share information with people that you may be going out with when it's a time that you feel that might be an important thing to do.
It's an exciting time to finish treatment. It's a difficult time in some ways. And there's, people may think to themselves, you know what, I'm struggling, or I'm struggling a little, I'm struggling a lot. How can people get help?
There are a lot of very wonderful resources, both often based in oncology centers, but also in the community as well. Certainly, and I think I had mentioned earlier, but the role of support groups, peer support from other patients who are further out. Because the end of treatment period is a high-risk period for issues with anxiety and depression. Individual counseling is often really very helpful. both for supportive counseling to talk about and work through some of the challenges and issues a person may be feeling. And cognitive behavioral work mm-hmm. is also very effective in working with depression and anxiety. The Survivorship Clinic is a wonderful resource here with multiple disciplines in it. Which is a great resource for people if that's something that they choose to do when they've been out for a while. Certainly trying to incorporate normal activities in life that can be contribute to self-care. And I often think in terms and speak of self-care after end of treatment and entering the survivorship phase for renewal, restoration, healing and recovery, and I certainly think in terms of multidimensional healing, medical, physical, emotional, psychological, and spiritual. People often find that it is meaningful to them to be able to give back in some way, that is actually something they also can do that is helpful. So I know many people that I work with will want to find a way to volunteer or to be present to another patient after some time has passed.
Yeah. This is all self-care as well.
Right.
So, I want to thank you. This has been a great session talking about the emotional recovery after treatment for women with gynecologic cancers.
Thank you. It's my pleasure.
And I'm Dr. Ken Miller, and this has been another segment of our ongoing series on living well beyond cancer.